Hello everybody, today I'm here with my third video from the series for dummies, and today we're taking a look at the gear wheels, the basic principles, the basic differences, and especially the way how to lock them properly in the build so they do not skip and grind their teeth. I'm not gonna waste so much time on calculating different gear ratios because Sariel has done already a tremendous job with his gear calculator that is available on his website. I'm gonna put the link down in the pinned comment and as well in the video description so you can take a look. First of all, we have two basic families of the gear wheels. The oldest ones are the ones that have the teeth that have a straight profile and they are only intended to run in a single plane next to each other, like this. And these are called spur gears. One of them is the 24 tooth gear wheel, the 8 tooth, the 16, etc., and the 40 tooth gear wheel as well. Then we have something that is intended to run at a 90 degree angle, and you can see that the teeth are cut. There's no big portion of the teeth that would be straight. So these can be used only at a 90 degree angle with another one, and these are called bevel gears. And last but not least, we have something which happens if you combine two of bevel gears back to back with each other, and afterwards you connect the teeth and create a middle section that is straight, and these are the double bevel gears, and they can run in a single plane or they can run at a 90 degree angle. When you're gearing up, you're using bigger input gear wheel towards a smaller output gear wheel. And as you can see, this tremendously increases the speed of the output gear wheel. But on the other hand, a higher force is required to spin it afterwards as soon as you put any load on this cross axle. If you gear down, you can make the function rotate slower. So you can see that I have to rotate this one three times before this makes one revolution. But this way you can tremendously increase the torque in the drivetrain. These are the two basic principles. So gearing up is going from big one to small one. Gearing down is going to going from the small one to big one. Another rule that you might find very useful is that if you have the gear wheels built in a single line and you need to figure out which way the drivetrain is going to rotate, if you have even numbers, the gear wheels are going to rotate opposite each other. So the first one and the last one will spin in a different direction. It's basically like if you put your fingers like this, the hands are kind of forced to move in opposite directions. As soon as you're getting to odd numbers of the gear wheels, you can see that the first one and the third one are spinning in the same direction. But what if you don't want to, or just can't have space for another gear wheel, or it doesn't allow you to take out one gear wheel out to change the rotation of the drivetrain? The Technic fork and the angular gearing is extremely helpful for that, because this way, if I rotate the brown cross axle, the red one is spinning clockwise. If I just place the gear wheel on the opposite direction and rotate it, you can see that it spins counterclockwise. So this way, just by changing the position of one of the gear wheels, you can simply reverse the drivetrain. One thing I would like to mention is as well how the free running gear wheels work. They were originally designed to be built into gearboxes, but it's not their only purpose actually, because you can, thanks to that, build multiple functions in very tight space. So if you rotate the green connector on the axle, you can see that only this drivetrain moves, allowing you to build a function further on this side without interfering with the other one. And if I rotate the cross axle with the blue connector, you can see that only this drivetrain moves without interfering with this one, which means you can continue building another function over here. Quite useful, right? Building gearwheels on a single beam like this is totally easy. You just need to use the legal combinations of the gearwheels. But what if you need to build them offset? There are actually two perfectly fine combinations of gearwheels which allow you to do something like this. So this way you have 16 and 20 tooth gearwheel running in an offset build, and this is totally fine, and as well it's great that you can lock it just by a single L-beam like over here. And the other combination that works totally fine is using the 24 and 12 tooth gearwheel. The build or the space that it occupies is almost the same, just be aware of that the 24 tooth gearwheel is slightly bigger than 3 modules, but gives you different gearing option. This is 16 to 20 and this is 12 to 24, or vice versa, depending which one will you use as your drive wheel and which one will be the output. But these are totally fine. When you are trying to lock the drivetrain as secure as possible, try to use a single part and afterwards optimally lock the gearwheels just by the beams as close to the gearwheels as possible. This, even on the higher torque, will not be able to slip, because you would lock it as well inside another structure and these gearwheels afterwards can't go anywhere. So try to lock from both sides if possible. When you're trying to lock gearwheels at an angle, I can't recommend these two parts high enough, because they allow you to lock them with a single part, and afterwards it's really difficult for the gearwheels to jump the teeth even under high torque. The only issue is that these parts are not that easy to distinguish which one is which. And they slightly differ in size, and there are of course different combinations available for each of these parts. So if we're gonna take a look at the smaller fork, you can build only this combo that works, which is 12 tooth and 12 tooth bevel gear, all of them the same size, so 1-to-1 gearing. That's the only available option for the small one. With the bigger one it gets slightly more interesting, because you can still build 1-to-1 gearing using the full double bevel and the bevel 12 tooth gearwheel inside this, but you have to use the two different kinds, otherwise it wouldn't fit. Or you can gear the function up or down just using the 20 tooth half bevel and the 12 tooth bevel gear like this. So if you drive the red cross axle, you're gearing down. If you drive the brown cross axle, you're gearing up. But what if you don't have or can't use the Technic fork? For example, if you're trying to build a gearing and lock it properly in an alternate model where there's plenty of other techniques, but this one works really nice, and it uses basically only two types of elements and two of each. So first of all, you take the lift arm and place it so this hole in the connector is horizontal and this one will be vertical, that way the gearwheels can mesh, and you just lock it with another L lift arm. And this one can use this combo, which is 12 and 12 tooth double bevel gear. It can use as well two 20 tooth bevel gears like this. And again, if you want to gear up or down, you can use 12 and 20. And depending by which axle you use as the input one, you can gear the function up or down in a very tight space. Right now, I think it's time as well to take a look at how to lock in the worm gears properly. So I'm gonna show you how to lock in the two module one and the newer one module long worm gear. Worm gears are extremely helpful if you need to slow the function tremendously down. This one is the fastest rotation which you can achieve with a Lego worm gear, which gives you a gear ratio of 1 to 8, because each revolution of the worm gear counts basically as a 1, and the number of the teeth on the gear wheel afterwards determines how much you slow it down. So this is the only 8-tooth gear wheel, so this is the fastest drivetrain you can build with worm gear. They are great as well for functions that need to be kept at a certain position, like crane booms, outriggers and whatnot, but I would definitely not recommend them for vehicle drivetrain, because the movement is kind of jerky, and afterwards the vehicle tends to like jump and like move in this manner instead of just going in a fluent motion. To lock the 8-tooth gear wheel with a worm gear, we need to just start with something like this. So I'm gonna take the 8-module axle with stop, then put the red connector over here, then the half bush, then you can slide your worm gear, repeat the same from the other side, like this. You can as well push the axles, the length doesn't matter. Right now I'm just using the 4-module cross axle, so you have the very same build as I'm showing you on the left hand side, and then you can take these 5-module lift arms and just lock this together like so. This allows the worm gear to rotate freely right now. Then we just need to drop in the 8-tooth gear wheel and put a cross axle of certain length over here. And this will be the arm which afterwards operates the function. So by spinning the dark gray axle, you rotate this lever, and you can afterwards add a longer beam if you want to demonstrate how the function rotates even better. The advantage of or disadvantage of having these cross axles little bit to the side is that it can actually work as a stopper for the function. So whenever it runs and hits any of the cross axles, the function can't move any further. Just be aware that if you motorize something like this, this might afterwards result in breaking of any of these parts. Probably the 8-tooth gear wheel will go as the first one. So build in some clutches before you try to motorize anything with worm gear. With the 24-tooth gear wheel, the situation is slightly different, because you need to build it more offset of the worm gear, for which we're gonna use the Technic triangles. But the basic principle is the same. So the cross axle, one connector, half bush, worm gear, half bush connector. Then again, I'm going to use the 4-module cross axles and just push each of the triangles facing the opposite direction than the worm gear. Otherwise you would block it, because it would rub against the worm gear. Then you can place the other one in, and then you can just put your 24-tooth gear wheel inside, push the cross axle in, and again I'm using this arm just to demonstrate how the function works. And this gear train is slowed 1 to 24 times, so one revolution of the dark gray cross axle, just move it by 1 24th of the revolution of the big gear wheel. This is much safer, especially when you need to put the drivetrain under higher torque, because the 24-tooth gear wheel is almost unbreakable. The last build with worm gear is going to show you how to lock in the 20-tooth bevel gear with the new 1-module worm gear. This is not the only build, but it's the simplest one to explain. So, similarly to previous ones, you're gonna take, in this case, the yellow connector, then red bush, the worm gear, another red bush, and the connector. And inside the cross holes, you're gonna put the 4-module axles. And then you can add the 5 module lift arms from each side. Then you're gonna put the 20 tooth gear wheel, put the cross axle in, and again the same arm with the 5 module beam. And this way you have a drivetrain with a 1 module worm gear. Was it helpful? I hope it was, and it gave you some hints on how to start working in the gear wheels inside your models. Did I miss anything out? If yes, then just leave a comment, let me know. And if you like the video, hit the like button. If you're new to my channel as well, do not forget to subscribe so you do not miss out on any of my future content. And do not as well forget to hit the notification bell. This way you get notified as soon as I upload a new video. And maybe, you know, in a few years, you will be able to build something like this with so many gear wheels inside that work together. Until next time, take care everybody, and bye bye.